licensing, and licensing consideration is the real truth. It's really something where when you're looking at on-premise licensing, that's something that's understood by most organizations. When it gets to the SQL Server side, when you're on-prem, sometimes they license it by cores, sometimes they license it by users. It can be that's the SQL side of SharePoint storage is a lot more complicated than actually the SharePoint licensing. But when you're looking at number two, the Office 365 SharePoint online licensing, that can be a little confusing sometimes. So really looking at which option is right for your organization. I really recommend doing a 30-day trial or doing, only committing to maybe a handful of licenses to understand what you're getting into, what you're really where you're wanting to go. You don't want to go out there and buy 500 licenses and not understand really where you're going. But I think that is where that roadmap, that is where that governance and kind of that pre-assessment, migration assessment, pre-cloud strategy. I call it the PPH strategy, public, private, hybrid strategy, and understanding where you want to go with that. So within that, you have the medium-sized business, you have the enterprise business, you have, of course, the most popular really being probably the E3 license right now. But again, the SharePoint Online has also its own, so you can do SharePoint Online without Office 365. Plan 1 and Plan 2 being the more advanced plan. Looking at option number 3, number 3 within Microsoft Azure. Now, this can be confusing, and they are trying to make it a little less confusing. But when you look at the calculator itself, and when you're looking at really, well, what do we want within Azure? Whenever you're doing that, really look at what hardware you currently have. A lot of times, whenever I help organizations select the type of Azure instances they're wanting to procure, sometimes they get a little too many cores, they get a little too much horsepower, because again, you can always scale up and scale back. So what you want to commit to, I think, is something that implementing a test environment in Azure, offboarding some applications or standing up some new applications in Azure, looking at the performance model. But again, the licensing there, when you're looking at the licensing in Azure, it really comes down, I feel, to security as well. You can have a instance of Azure, but unless you have that security, that Azure Active Directory, you may need premium depending on the two-factor authentication requirements of the organization. You may need to stand up some two-way hybrid sync between your SharePoint Online environment as well. But really understanding not only your servers, that's the easy part. 75% of Azure cost is compute. So always think of that. Storage is cheap when it comes to Azure. The other elements are going to be your connectivity and then your security licensing around Azure Active Directory, if you're going the premium route. And then also when you're talking about latency and talking about network, if you're a US-based organization, if you're in Great Britain, if you're in Canada, if you're really regional and you don't have a geolocated, or if you're not a multinational organization, you can select some of the plans where it doesn't do geo-replication. It does manage just 3 copies of your data rather than 6 copies of your data. So really understanding what type of platform you're really wanting, and what type of disaster recovery. You can also get away a little bit from having your current DR strategies. You can utilize Azure and the Azure instance to meet the needs of your DR. And there's some different tricks to doing that. But when you're looking also at number 5, understanding Azure Express Route. Azure and Office 365, the data centers, are in the same place. Microsoft had not yet officially announced this, but very soon they are going to basically take down the pricing in that. So anytime you connect to Azure, anytime you connect to Office 365 from the internet, basically you're not going to get that hop charge that you've been charged before. So they are in the same data center. But the express route is basically, if you're a large organization and you want to have a dedicated connection to the Azure data center, course, that, that hosts the Office 365 instances. You can get an MPLS connection, and you can get that gigabit connection to that data center. You can do some SSO with that. Again, some authentication comes around that as well. But with that, you have some DR as well. Should your internet go down within that the organization, you always have that connection, that gigabit connection in place. And again, looking at the overall bandwidth limitations. So you don't get charged when you upload content to Azure, but when you download content to Azure is when you get charged. So thinking about if you're doing migrations, you're doing test migrations. When you're migrating the data into Azure, you're not getting charged, but when you're pulling the data back out of Azure. So reverse migration strategies are key whenever you're thinking of hybrid, whenever you're looking at Azure. You never hear enough, and frankly, I don't hear anything at all about what is your reverse migration strategy. What happens if the organization's legal and retention policies change and you need to bring everything back on-prem? What is the cost of that? What is your strategy for that? How are you going to go about doing that? Again, something I really try to stress whenever I'm speaking to clients around migrating to Azure and also SharePoint Online. There's always got to be a reverse migration strategy. There's always got to be a way to reverse flip the switch should you need to do that. And again, month to month, yearly commitments and some pitfalls to avoid. Always get your feet wet with a month to month commitment. Always dive into, you can get right now the $200 free credit with Azure. Depending on what license you may have, typically you can get the $200 a month free credit. Start to test them out, start to get comfortable with them, and really from there, again, this is a whole nother side of this, but just understand the licensing and making sure that you're not getting hit with a massive bill, a surprise bill. But again, proper planning. And really understanding within your overall hybrid cloud approach and your cloud roadmap. Once you really vet these items out, you should be just fine. One major element that I don't think is talked enough about is administrative training. User training is talked about quite a bit, obviously, with whenever you're doing an upgrade to a new platform from SharePoint 2010 to 2013, or from SharePoint 2007 to 2010 to 2013. The ribbon, of course, you can upgrade and you can turn the ribbon on at a later date, or you're going to have some different options in the ribbon, apps versus web parts versus all these other options. But one thing to really think about is really training your users so that they understand what systems are in and how to manage those systems. When you're talking about organizations that have had on-premise implementations for the last 10 years, and then you're introducing a hybrid or a cloud-based implementation, and also continuing to manage your on-prem, you're going to have your disaster recovery strategies. You're going to have your security policies. You're going to have all of your different SLAs as far as again, how to what your clients can expect. And so it's really important to train your administrators, train your IT staff, not just the end users, which of course is always important. I don't want to take away from that, but really retraining the admins to now be comfortable with the hybrid cloud model, getting them comfortable with the admin consoles, understanding when things are being charged, when they're actually being charged for migrating content, when they're being charged for downloading content. Just again, it may be minuscule dollars here at the very beginning, but over time there are some policies and procedures and governance strategies you can put in place that will really not only save you money when you move to the cloud, but also save money around managing the cloud so that you're not paying for again services, or you're not paying for redundant type of procedures that, again, limiting mistakes, redundant things that can happen, getting away from that. When you're looking at, for example, number three, your IT stakeholders must now upgrade your organization's SharePoint governance model. So important. So you may have an existing security governance model. You may have site collection administrators. You may have folks that can have different types of rights within that. You may have customized your security model so that certain sites have security trim navigation, or you may have different types of responsive web design type navigation that has security trimming as well. You may need to scale that back in SharePoint Online and take away that server side code, putting in the client side code. But again, governance model must include, when it comes to SharePoint, SharePoint Online, Office 365. There is, again, with the different ways to turn on external sharing, different ways to manage the DirSync the DirSync portion of your ADFS and your Active Directory and your SharePoint users. Also, Exchange Online, of course, that may be something that you want to decide down the road, but also OneDrive for Business. So OneDrive for Business is something that can sometimes be overlooked. There's a 20,000 file limit right now when it comes to the sync tool. So whenever you're looking at migrating your file shares, your network file shares into OneDrive, again, think of the 20,000 file limit. What I do a lot with organizations is say, well, if you have a massive file share, it may be best to look at more of a SharePoint Online, creating a private site collection and creating document libraries that are more repositories. Again, that 20,000 limit is not a hard limit, but when it comes to the sync tool for OneDrive for Business can come into issues around the sync tool. OneDrive for Business is great also, really, it's great for personal network shares. So if you have personal network shares out there that have 2,000 documents and you want to migrate those over, but again, looking at what is the governance around not only SharePoint, of course, Office 365, but also OneDrive for Business, Skype, now Skype for Business, you're going to have, which previously linked, now Skype for Business, you're going to have presence indicators. You're going to be able to share and collaborate. Microsoft is coming out with some new features in SharePoint 2016 and also in some of the new releases of Office 365 where those Skype features are going to be increased. So it's important, again, to don't skimp over OneDrive for Business, Skype, also Yammer. If you're utilizing Yammer for your news feeds, doing any type of Delve, if you're utilizing Power BI for analytics, you may be using Performance Point or SSRS on-prem, and now you have this brand new shiny tool out in Power BI, which is awesome out in Office 365. But again, understanding all those different elements. You may have also your CRM Dynamics out there, or you may be wanting to turn on social listening. These social listening and these different, you know, Yammer, Delve, social listening, they do have a different security model. So when it comes to the security model, how are you going to really put into place a security model that's going to fit all of these different elements? So as